Thank you, Lord. Let me read this scripture. You like this one. You know part of it. You know Jeremiah 29? It's included. Jeremiah 29. Thank you, Lord. Just have your way, Lord. I mean that. Verse 10. 10 through 14. Yeah, verse 11, you know. For thus says the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you, and causing you to return to this place. So that was a promise that God was speaking through the prophet Jeremiah to Israel. He was telling them, you're getting ready to go through 70 years of hell. You're going to be taken captive. You're losing your freedom because you turned away from me. And I'm going to allow Babylon and the king to come in, carry you away from your land. Can you imagine that? 70 years in Babylon. And then God raised up a king over Babylon called Cyrus. And Cyrus, his heart was turned towards the Jews. And he returned them to their homeland. And people don't realize, but when the Jews came back into Israel, to the land of Canaan, you know, after 70 years, that place was inhabited by other people. Other people had moved in to the homes that were there and stuff. Other people were farming the ground. So Israel comes back and says, hey, that's my house. Hey, that's my land. And they say, what are you talking about? I've been here for 50 years. That didn't go over too well, by the way. Think about it. I mean, that's pretty... We don't even think about that stuff. So it wasn't like cut and dry and everything perfect. It's always messy. It just is. The kingdom's messy. Life is messy. You're going to have trials and tribulations. Things don't... But you always have him. He's always with you. He'll bring you through. I mean, can you imagine going up to this place saying, hey, this is my house, that's my barn, and that's my land, you're leaving. They're, no, we're not. No, we've been here. I've raised 3 kids here. I'm not leaving. There's a fight. But God said it, so it settled it, and they won. That's why they had to build with a shovel in one hand and a sword in the other one, you know. It's a war. We're in a war. Did you know that? Verse 11, because this is what God said. See, God already knew it was all going to happen. It says, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. See, so first he tells them all the bad stuff, and he says, look, I'm not doing this because I hate you or because I'm mad at you. I'm doing this for you, because you need, I've got to take you to a place where you will repent and return to me. Because I've got a purpose for your life. I've got a plan for your life. Anybody been around that mountain? Verse 12, then shall you call upon me. You shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. So, thank you, Lord. I'm just glad it's not going to take 70 years for me to get it. How about you? And you shall seek me and find me. I kind of like that. If we will seek him, he promises us that we can find him. That we will. And when you shall search for me with all your heart, and I will be found of you, says the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations. Sounds a lot like what I read this morning, huh? And from all the places whither I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you again into this place where I caused you to be carried away captive. Thank you, Lord. You know who Roland Baker is, or Roland Baker, Heidi Baker, Iris Ministries, Mozambique. Okay, you guys with me? They've raised up like over 10,000 churches. I can't remember how many millions, I guess it's in the millions now, of kids they feed every day. Wow. In the poorest country in Africa. Mozambique is the poorest, worst. They're in a drought right now. There's no food. They're just... Trust in God by faith. Anyway, Roland, in their core values. I don't think I shared it. I don't know. I might have said this morning, but I can say it again. This is what they teach their leaders when they're discipling and training up the people to work with them in their ministry. He says, when you seek God, when you seek God, you will find him. This is one of the verses they use. When you seek God, he says, you will find him. And then Roland adds this, and when you find him, seek him some more, and you'll find him some more. There's never an end to God. When you think you know him, you don't know him. When you seek him, when you find him, seek him again and find him some more. Because there's always a lot more that he wants to show us and give us. So don't ever be satisfied. Keep pressing in for more. Amen? Keep seeking him until you know him, that you know him. You know him better than you know the back of your hand. You know him better than you know yourself. He wants to make himself known. He wants to reveal himself to us. And he wants all of our heart. He wants to seek him. The Bible says in the New Testament, Paul said it this way, diligently seek him. If you diligently seek him, you're going to find him. Those that diligently seek him, he's going to show himself to us. So let's sing this song, You Won't Relent. We're going to try. I don't know if I can do this. We're going to try it again. My throat's gone. God will restore it. I don't know if we got the words right. I hope so. I'll try to remember. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. We need to make music loud. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. Sing it again. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. One more time. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
All set.
All set. You as a seal upon my heart, as a seal upon my arm. For there is love that is strong as death, jealousy demanding as the grave, and many waters cannot quench this love. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
Again.
You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. I'll set you as a seal upon my heart, as a seal upon my arm. For there is love that is strong as death, jealousy demanding as the grave, and many waters cannot quench this love. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. Come be
the fire inside of me. Come be the flame upon my heart. Come be the fire inside of me. Until you and I are one. Come be the fire inside of me. Come be the flame upon my heart. Come be the fire inside of me. Until you and I are one. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours,
Holy Ghost.
You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. All consuming fire, you're our heart's desire. Living flame of love, come baptize us, come baptize us. All consuming fire, you're our heart's desire. Living flame of love, come baptize us.
Yes,
come baptize us
again.
All consuming fire, you're our heart's desire. Living flame of love, come baptize us, come baptize us. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
Sing it again.
You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
Yeah.
You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. All consuming fire, you're our heart's desire. Living flame of love, come baptize us, come baptize us. All consuming fire, you're our heart's desire. Living flame of love, come baptize us, come baptize us.
Let us
fall more in love with you. Let us fall more in love with you. Let us fall more in love with you. Let us fall more in love with you. Let us fall more in love with you. Let us fall more in love with you. You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
Give him your heart tonight.
You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
Sing it again.
You won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours. won't relent until you have it all. My heart is yours.
Come on, let's give him a wave offering right now. Just lift your hands to the Lord. What you can't see is more real than what you can see. God dwells in the heavens. He knows you by name. He knows every hair on your head. He knows every day. Every one of your days is numbered by Him. He knows everything from the beginning to the ending. We worship you, Father. Our heart is yours, Lord. My heart. My heart is yours, Lord. Everything.
Heart is yours.
Have your way, Lord. Shandabur rebete pekete Brahma mandala basi. We love you, Jesus. Shoneri andala basso torolo bokekete Mondala masse de shikidi andolo bosso. She andala masse di arala basi. Kone la basa toshi kete te funda la babasi. Holy Spirit, have your way with me, Lord. Have your way with me, Lord. First love. Come on, remember your first love. Go back to your first love. That first love, His name is Jesus. He saved your life. Pulled you up out of the darkness. He pulled you up out of the muck and the mire. Thank you, Lord. Just soak that in. Of His love tonight. He's pouring out the love wine, the wine of His love tonight, His blood that was shed on the cross for you and I. That blood is that wine of His new covenant with us. You got to become a new wineskin to drink that new wine in. You got to be a new wineskin to drink that new wine in. Shuramamanda, receive that love. Take a drink of His love tonight. Ah, He set His love upon you. His love is shed abroad in your hearts. Be full of His love tonight till it overflows you. Till you just gotta love somebody. You gotta give somebody else a drink of that love. You're so full and overflowing that you just gotta go find somebody and pour it out on them. Give them a drink. So I want you to go where you are right now. I want you to put your hand on somebody and I want you to just to give them a drink. Just release that love that's in your heart into their heart. Just release that. Just put your hand on their shoulder. Put your hand on them. Just hold their hand. Just release. Here, have a drink. Take a drink. And then you give them a drink back after they pray for you. Just release and give them another drink. Ooh, give them a drink of the Holy Ghost. Give them a drink of the love of the new wine. I give my baby a drink. I get her drunk in the Holy Ghost. Shh, just have a drink, honey. Drink His love. I mean, you know we're a mess, but He's a mess maker. He's a fixer. I guess that's the way to say it. He's a message. His message is love. Take a drink. Just drink. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe upon him would not perish but have everlasting life. Sipper. Whew. He knows how to drink. That's good. Give Carl a drink tonight, Lord. My spirit upon all flesh. His sons and daughters will drink and get drunk and prophesy. Paraphrasing. They're going to open their mouth and I'm going to fill it. And then they're going to prophesy too. Prophesy the word of the Lord. They're going to say what I'm saying. Whoa, they're going to be so full of me they can't keep their mouth shut. Your young men are going to see visions. Your old men are going to dream dreams. Oh, in that day, oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, Joel chapter 2. Yeah, he quoted it, didn't he? I want to read Joel 2:28, though, if I can get my phone to open up. I'm going to give some more people a drink here. We're not done. You better keep drinking. Oh, thank you, Lord. If you want to shout, get under the spout. Holy Ghost. Oh, thank you, Lord. Whoa. I'm going to start in verse 23. What's up with 23s today? Be glad then, you children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain. The rain, see, Raina. You're in the Bible. Rain, short for Raina. Oh, for the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. And the floor shall be full of wheat, and the fat shall overflow with wine and oil. And I will restore to you. Wow. This is it, Gail. I'm being drawn to you. I see your name on this verse. It's verse 25. The Lord says, I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, that the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you, you shall eat in plenty, and you shall be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you. And my people shall never be ashamed. He's going to take away your shame. He's given you his name. No more shame. You have his name. He married you. He's blessed you. And I'm prophesying to you, Gil Barclay. The Lord is going to restore everything that's been lost. Everything that's been ruined. Everything that's been tainted. Everything that's been marred. Everything that's been stolen. Everything that's been twisted, everything that's become a perversion, the Lord will restore, and he will restore seven times greater. The Lord will restore because you set your heart upon him. You believe his word. And you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God. I am. He's the great I am. Ooh, I am. See, that's present participle. In other words, he's present. He says, I am, and he's just, I am. He's now. He's a now God.
not some day later. Not he was yesterday, but not today. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I am the Lord your God and none else. And my people shall never be ashamed. He's breaking off shame tonight. If you got any shame, he's breaking it off. And he's giving you his name. There's no shame in his name. This is verse 28. And it shall come to pass afterward, after all of that, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered, or shall be saved, sozoed in the Greek. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. Many are called, but few are chosen. You know why? Because of the response of our heart. You qualify, and you can disqualify. Jesus qualified you. It's all about the heart. We don't want to disqualify ourselves. Don't stop now. I'm on a roll. Thank you, Lord. Come on. Yeah, exactly. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just start playing softly, okay? Minstrel. Play by the Spirit. Get your head out of the way and let your heart take over. Give Judy a drink, Lord. He's going to give her a drink. This is a spirit. This is how you drink in the spirit. Let's have a big old drink. Take a drink of his love, the new wine. Spiritual drink. Wow. Fill her up, Lord. Till her heart just burst open. Till it just got to overflow. And your love just pours out. Wow, thank you, Jesus. I'm going to pray for you, okay? Father, just give Clayton a drink right now. Pour out your spirit, Lord, upon him. Oh, thank you, Lord. All insecurities just leave now. Power. Love, power, and a sound mind comes into him now. Thank you, Lord, for confidence and boldness. Wow, Jesus. A man of God. A man after your own heart. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Spirit, the living waters, the new wine. Touch your Father with your love. Bless her today, Father. Reina, the Lord sees you like a beautiful flower that's just growing up in his garden. I heard the Lord say, she's my flower girl, the flower child. You like flowers? They're beautiful. Well, you're like that. You're a beautiful flower to the Lord. When he looks at you, that's why he sees you like a beautiful flower, like a beautiful rose. Thank you, Jesus. Aiden, Lord, just touch him right now. Give him a drink, Father. Whoa.
you, Lord, for the prophetic anointing. Oh, for the prophet, Lord. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Whoa. Whoa, thank you, Lord. Did you call him, Lord? You've called him before the womb. Did you call him in the womb, Lord? A prophet to the nations. Thank you, Lord, for the prophetic gifting, impartation, anointing. Give him a drink of your spirit, Lord. Oh, yeah. Bless these kids, Lord. Thank you for them, Father. Oh, Shaka Baba, see. Latter days will be greater than the former days. The latter days, your latter years will truly be golden, says the Lord. Because I'm going to show you the true riches. I'm going to give and share with you the real true treasures of heaven. I'm going to take you into my vault. Oh, I'm going to allow you access in. I'm going to show you the hidden things, the secret things that I've kept for most, but I'm going to share them with you because you have proven yourself to be trustworthy, says the Lord. You have been faithful in the little that I've given to you, so I'm going to give you double now, and then that will double, and then that will double, and then that will double. And as you continue to serve me with your whole heart, and as you continue to be faithful over that which I place within your hands and under your authority and power, I will continue to expand you. I will continue to increase you. I will continue to pour out upon you of my spirit. And there will be no end, says the Lord. They will just go from glory to glory to glory. You're going to meet him if you haven't. You're going to meet Enoch. He's going to give you an impartation. Ooh, of translation. Oh, thank you, Lord. Enoch was shown the mysteries. Thank you, Lord. And I believe that you're supposed to get the book of Enoch. You need to read the book of Enoch, but you need to be careful. There's three different Enochs out there, okay? Two of them are bogus. They're absolutely trash. They're junk. It's made up fiction. There's one that's the true book of Enoch. That it was actually, everything in it was quoted by him, spoken by him, written the truth about him. And it's the Ethiopic or the Ethiopian version. It's the one they found with the Dead Sea Scrolls. That's the only true book. The other two are garbage. It's just the enemy trying to mar Enoch's name. He hated Enoch because Enoch could do what he couldn't do. Walk among the stars. Look for it. Expect. Don't be surprised when it begins to make.
Would you make Laura a sign and a wonder to this generation, Father? I ask you, Lord, make her a sign and a wonder even to us. Let her be known as the Golden Girl. The manifestations of gold be a normal everyday occurrence in her life. Thank you, Lord. Give her a drink of the golden wine. Wow. Thank you, Lord, for the strong one. You strengthen her today, Lord. That she will be known as a strong woman of God. Strength. Strength will be the mark upon you. You will become strong. He's going to impart to you the spirit of might. It's the spirit of his strength, of his power. You're going to be a strong one. You're going to be a strong one. You've been through the trials that will make you stronger. He's just wanting you to exercise your spiritual muscles. This has all been preliminary. It's all been training leading up to the main event, says the Lord. You haven't even entered into the main event. I'm going to do through you exceeding abundantly above all that you have asked or even thought of me, says the Lord. I am going to make you a standard. I am going to make you a standard that others are going to look to you and say, man, I don't know how she stands. She's so strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Ha ha ha. Whoa, oh, don't call weak what God calls strong. Oh, thank you, Lord. Power, might, strength, dominion, strong one. As soon as I came by you, the Lord said, my strong one, my strong one. When you are weak, he is strong. He is made strong in you, and you are made strong in him. No more weak, but strong. He's going to make you the head and not the tail. You are not the tail that the head wags any longer. You are the head. You are the head. You are the head. Put a strength in her, Father. Down her backbone, Lord. She will not bow. She will not cower. She will stand as a standard of uprightness and righteousness, as a lightning rod in the earth for your presence, Lord, for your glory to strike. Whoa. And I believe that you are going to begin to have manifestations of the oil in your hands and your body. You're going to begin to see the oil, supernatural flow of his oil, of his anointing, of his oil. Even in your hands, the oil will flow. Ooh, out of your forehead, out of your head, the oil will flow down. It will start at the top of your head, and it will flow down. The oil will flow. The oil will flow. And it will be a sign that will make the people wonder, what is this? You will say, it's the oil of gladness, because my God has made me glad. Not sad, glad. He's going to make you glad. You wait and see, watch and see that the Lord is good. you're going to say that. Watch and see. The Lord is good to me. Oh, he's been so good to me. That's going to be your testimony. See a new decree being written in heaven concerning you and your people, concerning you and your family. Whoa. There's a new decree being written in heaven. Whoa. Thank you, Lord. It's the word of the Lord. It's the word of the Lord. You are the head and you are not the tail. That you are the accepted and not the rejected. That you are the above and not the beneath. That you are victorious and not downtrodden. That you are more than conquerors through Jesus Christ. That you will overcome by the blood of the Lamb, the word of your testimony, not loving your life, even unto death. You will lay it down for your God and for your people. And the Lord honors you today. And there's a new decree that's been released out of heaven. There are new assignments of angels that are now being released. Wow. Golden angels. Angels. They're white angels with golden wings. And they're being released to you now to bring forth righteousness in your family. To bring forth righteousness in your people. To bring forth your seed. To bless your seed. To water your seed. To bring increase. And righteousness will rise up. Thank you, Father. You are like a tree planted beside the river. Spirit. just wants you to be with him. It's all about that love relationship. He just wants you to get to know him in a deeper and a more intimate way. Yeah. He wants intimacy with you. He wants you to be close to him. It's not about what you do for him. It's who you are to him that matters the most. He just wants you to be with him, to spend time with him. He loves you. Just love him back and let him just pour out over you waves of glory, waves of love, waves of glory, waves of love. And in the midst of that, you're going to receive healing. You're going to receive restoration. Whoa. Manifestations of his love and his glory. You're going to receive healing in that. Healing. Inner healing. Thank you, Jesus. I'm telling you, you're going to be in to have encounters with him. In a whole new way, on a whole new level. Intimacy, closeness than you've ever been. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for Daniel, Lord. Oh, that you're doing a work in him, Lord. Wow. Oh, Jesus, thank you, Lord. Give him a drink of the new wine. Wow. Ooh, it's the fire and glory. Ooh, it's the fire and glory. It's the fire and glory wine. It's the fire and glory wine. It's a mixed wine of the fire and the glory. Oh, man. Thank you, Lord. My hand's so hot. Thank you, Lord, for the fire and the glory. That new wine, it's a wine that's just for you for this time. Just drink that new wine. He's renewing that wineskin. Wow. He's renewing the wineskin. It's a new you. It's a new day. It's a new way. Oh, it's a new mindset. It's a new understanding. Not an old way, a new way. Not what they say. Oh, but what he does in you. He's changing that old wineskin to a new wineskin. And he's giving you the new wine. It's the wine of fire and glory. Fire and glory. Fire and glory. No water can put it out. Nothing can stop it. Darkness in the world can't put out the light that's in you. The Lord's even going to begin to show you, Daniel, things to come. You're going to begin to see into the future. He's going to show you events. You're going to see names. You're going to begin to see dates. You're going to begin to see demonstrations and things in the spirit of what is to come. The world would call them a premonition, but the Lord calls it his prophetic gifting upon you. Ha 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 ha. He's going to show you things to come. You're going to just know things. The only way to know them is by the Spirit. But you're going to know things, and you're going to sound the alarm, and you're going to be able to prepare a people for what's coming. Ha. You're going to begin to speak and share what the Lord is showing you, and it's to prepare a people for what he's about to do in the land. I thank you, Lord. Whoa. That everything you show us, Lord, is for our good and not our evil. To bring life to us and not death. To bring blessing to us. To bring increase in our lives. I thank you, Lord. That when Daniel speaks, we will listen. Thank you for the mantle. Mantle upon this man and the mandate upon his life. use him, Lord, for your glory. Just press into him. Spend more time with him. He's going to show you things to come. Wow. Don't doubt it in your heart. Just write it down. You're going to begin to see things that you write down. They're going to come to pass. In the very beginning, they're going to come very quickly. He's going to show you just a few days something that's going to happen. You're going to write it down, and then you're going to see it happen. You're going to watch it with your own two eyes. Be walked out just like you saw it in the vision, just like you saw it in the spirit. Then he's going to begin to stretch you out a few weeks. Then he's going to begin to show you things a few months off. Then he's going to begin to show you a year, what's going to happen in the next year. Whoa. He's even going to take you and show you things in the next millennium when we're with him. In all of his glory, you're going to have visions. You're going to see those things. The Lord says, my eye is within you. Just a minute longer. I got two back here that I missed. While it's flowing, I better get them. Oh, don't stop. What's the matter with you? Shakavasit. Lord, sometimes it's hard to find good help. He's oblivious. Thank you, Lord. Stretch your hands out back here toward Victoria. Is that your real name? The Lord calls you Victoria, whether you like it or not. Thank you, Lord, for Victoria, that she's elegant. Oh, that she's a queen, Lord, that she's royalty. That's the way you see her, Father. You bless her, Lord. You honor her. Just take a drink of his love, that royal love. The wine of the king. You're going to get to sit at the king's table. You're not going to sit out there in the table far away with the help and the paupers. You're going to sit at the king's table. He's going to bring you in to the banqueting room, and he's got a seat reserved for you at the banqueting table, at the king's table. You're going to sit right with him, and you're going to eat the king's food, and you're going to drink the king's wine. And you're going to hear the conversation of the king, saith the Lord. You're going to hear what the king is saying in the innermost chambers, in the innermost places, in the depthness, in the deepness, in the intimacy. You're going to hear what the king is saying, because he's going to draw you near, right into his table. And you're going to sit. Off the spirit of Laodicea. I release the spirit, the burning spirit. spirit, the spirit of burning. I release that spirit of burning into your life. Set her on fire, Lord. Let her be a burning one. A burning one, a light in the darkness, Lord. A shining one, Lord. Shine. 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 With His light and His glory. His fire in you. Wow, thank you, Jesus. Overcome. Overcomer. Last but not least, everybody pray with me for our bestie here. This is our bestie. This is our BFF, our best friend forever. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Father, give her a drink. Give her a drink. Give Amy a drink, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, Jesus. Amy. Wow. What? The Lord's telling me to ask you your middle name. Lynn. Amy Lynn. Amy Lynn, I decree over you, I prophesy over you, that you are the head and you are not the tail, that you are above and you are not beneath, that you are blessed and not cursed. That you are favored, highly favored, above others. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy that follow her all the days of her life. Thank you, Lord, for great favor. Just take a drink of that wine of His favor. Just receive the favor of the Lord. I see everything that you put your hands to turns to gold. Ooh, sheme, sanam, shuku, burra, patata. Every heart that you touch, you will turn it to gold. You will become golden, full of His glory. Wow. Oh, as you gather them in, like a mother hen, you're going to gather them in, and you're going to provide for them safety, protection, confidence, self-esteem, security, boldness, wow, an overcoming spirit.
Saying is a full service gas station. Y'all remember that? Where you could pull up in that gas station and the attendant would come out, ask you how much you wanted. $5 of gas, $10. And while he was pumping that in, pumped in slower than now. So he would go on and wash your windows. Then if you wanted, they'd check the air in your tires, raise the hood, check your oil, check your gas, did it all. Well, God said that's how what they're going to refer to this. It's not going to be a church. It's going to be a house of God, but it's going to be a full service house of God. That's what the people are going to call this place. He said, because I have placed people here that have my heart in them. They have the love that I have. He said, they have allowed my Holy Spirit to perfect that love in them. That's for I have many hurting people in this area, and I've had nowhere to take them to where they can be serviced, where I can give them a full service. He said, they will be waiting at the doors to get in here to be serviced. He said, even now do I have people here that are starting to do that. But he said, I placed them here and will continue to place them here, so this will be a full service house of God.
Called it a filling station, didn't they? Full. Fill her up. Pull up there, it's 25 cents a gallon, man. Fill her up. Thank you, Lord. Okay. What's their name? Last name? Huh? Caraway. And they're wanting to sell their business. Is that what we need to pray for? Okay, we're just going to break that hold right now. Yeah. Well, you can go tell them we prayed. It's going to happen. They're going to see it happen. Lord, I thank you right now. We lift up this to you. This restaurant, Bella's Restaurant, Lord, in West Frankfort. Is that right? Thank you, Lord. What did you say the name was? There you go, Father. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, I just ask you to move on their behalf. I release the angels of God out of this court of the angels to go now. You go and fulfill this word. We decree from heaven. We decree that this business will sell. It will be for the full amount. We remove any obstacle right now. We break it off. Any stronghold, we break it now. Anything holding back the sale, we break it now. In the name of Jesus. And we release blessing. We release favor. We release the power. We release the words. And we release the angels to bring this to pass. And I thank you for it, Lord. Whoa. Yeah, I thank you for it, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you're going to break through, and then they're going to turn and they're going to bless you. That's what I hear the Lord saying. He's going to break through, then they're going to see it, and they're going to return, turn back to the Lord and bless. Then they're going to bless him. Thank you, Lord. Holy Ghost. Wow. So we had the love thing, and we've got the stronghold thing. Which message am I supposed to bring, Lord? You guys just hit both of them. Oh, Lord. Now I'm confused. What? Thank you. Why not? Ooh, yeah. Yeah. They don't know if it is or not. Okay. Father, we just curse that thing right now. We declare, Lord, no matter what it is now, we decree and we declare it as benign. I thank you for that, Lord. Your word. You sent your word and healed our disease. Lord, they're going to go in, so Lord, just let them find that you have beat them to the punch. That you beat him, Lord, on that cross. We speak healing. We speak wholeness to her. We speak health. We declare over her she will live and not die in the name of Jesus Christ. That she will live long and prosper. That she will have a long life. She will have a blessed life. And she will have a healthy life. We curse that thing.
Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Okay, I will be too then. All right. Thank you, Lord. Wow. Just listen to the Lord for a minute, okay? The Lord just said 22, then he said, look at your phone, 622. What's that mean, Lord? Thank you, Lord. I know what it means. If you got a Bible, turn with me to Genesis chapter 22. Isn't that cool? You can't make that up. I couldn't have timed that. You realize that, how awesome that is, how big he is? Did you miss it? You missed it. The Lord just spoke 22 to me, and he said, pick up your phone and see what time it is. It was 622. Isn't that cool? Wow. Thank you, Lord. Why is 22 important? Because there's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet, and the 22nd letter is the letter Tav. Guess what it is? There's a symbol with every letter of the Hebrew alphabet. You know, like in Egypt, there were hieroglyphics. It was a picture, an image. Well, the Tav is the cross because it's the last letter. It was the last letter before the new beginning, before we go back to the beginning. Start with Aleph, which is God. The first letter is Aleph. It's the ox, and it's the Father. He's the beginning. Before the beginning, there's the cross. That's why the Lamb was slain before the foundations of the earth were laid. Because the Lamb was slain on the cross. And that is the foundation. 22 is a foundation number. It's Isaiah 22:22. The keys of David. He gave us the key of David. What you open will be open. What you close will be closed. Isn't that what he said? What he opens, no man can shut, and what he shuts, no man can open. That's the keys, the 22 keys. You got a key ring with 22 keys on it. They're the living letters of light. They're the Hebrew alphabet, the alphabet, and the 22nd letter is the Tav, it's the cross, it's the place of the new beginning, it's the birthing of righteousness. And then we have a picture in the Bible. How many of you know in the Old Testament is concealed what was revealed in the New Testament? In the Old Testament, you find the shadow. In the New Testament, you bump into the substance of it. And so here's a shadow in Genesis 22 that's connected with Isaiah 22. By the way, is known as the Messianic chapter in Isaiah. And then we have Psalms 22, which is the Messianic psalm because it talks about the Messiah hanging on the cross and that, you know, he was bruised and beaten without unrecognizable. That's Psalms 22. Describes Jesus hanging on the cross before he did it because he'd already done it. Before he did it, he'd already done it. Hallelujah. Everything in the Spirit's finished. God sees the beginning to the ending. Here's a way to realize that. We're going to Genesis 22. I just throw some little nuggets out here. This is how God sees things. He's outside of time and space. Time, space is the fourth dimension. Okay, we live in a three-dimensional world, you know, three dimensions to everything. You know, one dimension would be like a flat piece of paper, you know, just like a line. If it's sideways, it would just look like a line. It's two-dimensional. Three-dimensional, then you add width to it or breadth to it. Fourth dimension is the time-space continuum. They don't even separate time and space anymore. It's the same. They treat it as the same. Because when you're under time, you're in space. When you're in space, you're in time. God sets outside of time and space. He created this dimension, and he put us in it. But we're learning how to go out of it, how to go above it, to go where he is, outside of it. So it's like stepping outside. It's like if you're sitting watching a parade, because right now there's a lot of parades going on. Okay? And this is what it's like to live in a three-dimension when you're in time and space.
You sit on the street corner and you watch the bands and you watch the floats and the people go by one after another. But you can only see like one frame, you know, at a time. You don't see the whole thing from beginning to end. You see it as it comes. But see, being outside of time and space is being like lifted up above the parade, like in a helicopter or whatever. You levitate. You go up above, high enough, outside of this, so you can see the beginning of the parade to the ending of the parade and everything in the middle of the parade. That's God's perspective. That's how he sees everything. He's outside of it. So all he has to do is speak into it when he wants something to get done. So he can call those things that be not as though they already were, because they already were in the was, in the beginning. We may be halfway through the parade right now, but see, God sees the ending and the beginning. And if he wants to bring that beginning to the middle, all he's got to do is decree it, declare it, speak it so, release it, and boom, there it is. Yeah, that's how it works. Speaking, the power of death and life are in our tongue. And so anyway, so we got Jesus going to a cross, the Father's Son. You know, the Father sent his Son, right, to die on a cross for us. Yeah, that's what he did. It's always been about a father and a son. It's always about a relationship. And you're a son. We're the sons. It's still about the father and the sons. And so this story in Genesis chapter 22 is about a father and a son. It's Abraham and Isaac going up on Mount Moriah. Isn't that good? This is the beginning. This is a picture. This is a picture of what was going to happen with a son on a cross. A son laying his life down, a father sending his own son and allowing his son to be crucified. They didn't kill Jesus. It says he laid down his life. He gave it freely. The Father gave up his son for us. And Abraham was willing to give up his son here in this story in Genesis 22, starting in verse 2. Isaac and Jacob. And by the way, it's about a relationship and it's about a love relationship. It's about a love covenant. The word in Hebrew for mercy is the word hesed. It's C-H-E-S-E-D. I'm probably not pronouncing it right. So yeah, that's okay. You don't know either. We don't speak Hebrew. It's okay. But what we got to understand is it's the word for love or for mercy. And there's a word connected to it. And right here in Genesis 22:2 is the first time there is a Hebrew word that appears in the Bible for love. It's the first word for love in the Bible. It wasn't back in Genesis 1 with Adam and Eve coming out of his side. It's here in Genesis 22 with a man named Abraham and a son named Isaac, because this is true love. This is the love that's connected to the mercy of God. And it's the word ahab, A-H-A-B, ahab. Okay? Now, let's just read this. So I need to change my phone to Genesis, the beginning, 22, just starting in verse 1. Sarah was 107 and 20 years old. Wow. 127 years old. Woo-wee. These were the years of the life of Sarah. I'm at the wrong. Sorry. My fat finger got in the way. I'm in 23. That was good. She lived 127 years. Interesting. It's 127. Yeah. God's still sneaking one in on me. Anyway, I keep seeing a lot of 127s. It's Colossians 127 for me. Okay, I'll start now in verse 1. This made more sense. And it came to pass after these things that God did tempt Abraham. That word means to prove him. He wanted to prove Abraham. He wants to prove you too. God already knew what Abraham was going to do. So who was being proven here, really? Abraham was being proven to Abraham. God was going to show Abraham what was in his heart. God already knew what was in it. He didn't need to do this. He knew. But Abraham didn't know. So after this, Abraham knows that he knows that he knows. Yeah. He did tempt to prove Abraham and said unto him, Abraham. And he said, "Behold, I'm here. Here am I." Isn't that kind of cool? You stop and think about that. God and Abraham had such a relationship that God says, "Hey, Abraham." Abraham, "Hey, I'm over here, God. What do you want?" You know, that's the way it was. They were friends. Wow. Think about it. I mean, Abraham wasn't blown away because God said, "Hey, I want to talk to you." He said, "I'm over here." It's like, I mean, if God called me, I think I'd go running to him. "Abraham, I'm over here. Come over here if you want to talk to me." That's really what he was saying. "I'm here. What do you want?" "You got something to say? Come say it," you know. And he said, "Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac." Who is Isaac? Isaac was the promise. Isaac was the one. He was the seed that all what God had promised Abraham and prophesied to everything hung on this son. This was the promise. This was the fulfillment. This was it. "Whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah." Moriah is really important in this story. Okay, so just remember Moriah. "And offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains, which I will tell thee of." So Moriah is a region, not just a little place. Moriah is a region. Moriah, it was a high place. And when Abraham, if he would obey the Lord and go to Moriah, then the Lord would show him which mountain to go up on. I just submit to you that they started out upon a natural place, but they ended up in a supernatural place. That mountain he went up on was not here. It was there. It was in another realm. Because this is a picture of the Father sacrificing, crucifying his son through obedience to what God wanted. He was willing to even give up the promise and all that God has spoken to him because of his relationship with God, because he loved God. He would do whatever God asked of him. I'll say it again. Has God gotten from you what he wants? Are you giving him what he wants from you? Which is your undevoted heart love. Your whole heart loving him. Not because of something he can do for you. Not because of what he did for you. Not because of what he can give to you. But because you just love him. You love him because he first loved you. He died for you, so you're going to die for him. That's a true covenant love. Abraham rose up early in the morning, saddled his ass, took two of his young men with him, and Isaac, his son. Two's the number of witness. He clave the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went up to the place of which God had told him. And we know what happens there. I mean, you know the story. So I'm not going to go into this. But what I want to go into is the Hebrew here. Because I want to give you a full understanding of what's going on here. Because this is the picture of the father giving up his son. Okay? This is the picture. This is the place where it was accounted to Abraham because of his faith that he would be righteous. And that righteousness would be imparted to Abraham, and that it would be imparted to his seed all the way down through. Because out of the loins of Abraham would come a David, and out of David would come a Solomon all the way down. And that then out of that lineage would come the Messiah. That was the promise. To Isaac, this promise of a son would come, the Messiah that would save Israel later on. And so here's the first thing. In verse 1, the word God here is the word Elohim. Okay, I'm going to give you a little teaching here. Elohim. Why is that? Why didn't he use Yahweh? Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Why did God call himself in the scriptures when he had Moses write this? He said, "My name is Elohim." Because Elohim is the personable God. Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh is the fearful God. Elohim is the he's the creator, but he's the nurturing side of God. It's the loving, the fatherly, the motherly, fatherly side of God. He was
coming to Abraham as a friend, not as Almighty God, powerful, smoke, thunder, like, you better bow down and be scared of me. No, he was coming to him as his friend. He's Elohim. Elohim, every Hebrew letter has a numerical value. Like Aleph, the first letter is 1. Yod, the 10th letter is 10. Tav, the 22nd letter, is 400. Okay, they all have a different numerical value. They go by 1s up to 10. Then they go 10, then the 11th letter is 20, 12th letter is 30. Then they count by 10, so they get, and then all of a sudden it switches. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, then 50 jumps to 100, then 200, 300, 400, the end. Okay, that's just the way that's God, that's what he did. Now, so Elohim, so every Hebrew word, if you add up the numerical value for every letter in that word, then each word has a gematria or a numerical value. That's important in Hebrew. That's really important to the Hebrews, this language. So you got the milk, we got the meat, and then there's the mystery. There's the mystical meaning in Hebrew. There's 3 layers to Hebrew. There's even more than that, but that's the basic 3. Usually we only get to the milk, and then we don't even understand. Anyway, Elohim has a gematria or a numerical value of 86. Okay, thinking like a Hebrew, when you look at 86, you see 8 and 6. Because 6 is the number of man, 8 is the number of new beginnings. So only through Elohim will there be a new beginning for mankind. That's what it means. That's what his name means, a new beginning for all men. So God was coming to Abraham. And see, so Abraham understood this. Abraham knew he's coming as Elohim. That's who he's calling himself to me. So I know there's going to be a new beginning. So it doesn't matter what he asks of me. It doesn't matter that he's asking me to sacrifice my son. There will be a new beginning. In other words, he understood that even if he sacrificed him, he would give him back. He would raise him from the dead. He would do whatever it took because he's the God of the new beginning for all men. Wow. And then 8 plus 6. Now, there are limits to how you play around with the numbers, okay? Some of the stuff you do is not right, but I don't correct you on it right now. I'm just letting you have fun. And it's okay, go for it. She sends me stuff all the time on the phone. I said, what are you talking about? Anyway, then she explains it. I said, oh, okay, now I got to think like Judy, not like Hebrew. Think like Judy for a minute. Anyway, I'm being ornery right now to you. It's okay. You can take it. So, but they do. They would see 86, 8 plus 6 is what? Come on, math wizards, 14. What's 14? If they see the number 14, that's the 14th letter, which is the noon, which is the letter for Messiah. So see, Isaac was a picture of the Messiah. He was the promised son. So all of that's in the name that God chose to use for Abraham. That's why it's so important. Okay? 8 times 6 is 48. They do that too. What's 48? 4 and 8. What? 4 is the new door. 8's what? A new beginning. So God's going to open up the door. He knew that he would. And if you take 4 and 8 and add them, you get 12, which is the fullness of his government, which is what rested upon the shoulders of Jesus Christ. It's Isaiah 9:6, Isaiah 22:22. It's the government of God being established through a father and a son relationship. The government of God today is going to be established based on a father and son relationship. The father there, the son's here. You're the sons of God, whether you know it or not. You're the sons of God and you're equal. Jesus said this, you're equal. I will make you equal to me. Wow. You're equal to me. I count you as an heir and a co-heir, a joint heir with me. Not a lesser son, a full son just like me. I brought you in. I've adopted you through my blood. I've made you a new creation, equal with him. Wow. I mean, wow, come on, think about it. I'm equal. When the Father looks at me, he looks at me as equal with his son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. That'll blow your mind. That's how God looks at you. Well, what happened if we started looking at ourselves that way? That's what Jesus did. He believed who he was. I mean, he could have believed that he was just Joseph and Mary, but he believed what his mother told him.
He believed what the scriptures and what the Spirit told him. He believed what John prophesied. This is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. I mean, Jesus had a choice. He could have allowed unbelief to enter in, doubt, which is the womb for unbelief to begin to manifest in you. He could have doubted it, but he didn't. He was the Son, and he knew it. He had to grow up, though, just like we do. But anyway, we're equal to that. So all of that's in the name Elohim. Amazing, huh? And it's all about a father and a son. I'm on verse 1. Verse 2. Let me read verse 2 again. This is the main verse. And he said, take now thy son, thy only son Isaac. By the way, Isaac, I think I said this morning, means laughter. Joy. See, Isaac was the joy of Abraham's life. He was the son that he'd been waiting for. Abraham and Sarah finally had a son together. Not an Ishmael with his concubine, but with Sarah's handmaiden, Hagar, created an Ishmael. Which is where all you get all the Arab nations, where all the Muslims come from. They're all descendants of Ishmael. Ishmael hated Isaac, still does to this day. Whoa, that's why you have wars. Anyway, oh, Jesus, okay. So it says he loved. That word love is the word ahab. Okay, I'm not going to bore you with all the details, but the gematria, the numerical value of that word for love here, the first time the word love is ever used in the Bible is right here. That's called the law of first mention. That's really important. You got to get this. The law of first mention. The first time it's mentioned in the Bible is where you're going to find the original intent, the original motivation, the original purpose of why God was establishing that thing. So here it is. Here's the Father and the Son. Here's the Father going to sacrifice his Son because he loved God that much. The Father would give up his Son. It was a picture of God Almighty sending his only begotten Son to earth to die for a bunch of sinners so we could be redeemed and restored into fellowship, into relationship with him. The numerical value of Ahab, you could probably guess it, it's 8. It's the new beginning, a new life. Because if God so loved the world, that's how it started. Because of his love, we now have a new beginning, don't we? We have the new life. 8 is the letter het in the Hebrew alphabet, and it means life. It's the huppah at the wedding. It's the marriage covenant. It means agreement. And when you add up, the het is made of two letters. The word, the letter het, you know, the letter het, the 8th letter, its name, het, actually is made up of 2 other letters. So that's what you're going to see is these Hebrew words, even the letter is made up of other letters. They work together. There's no letter by itself. They're all connected. It's a picture of the body of Christ. It's a picture of what every church is supposed to be. There's supposed to be 22 different kinds of churches. We're one church in heaven and earth. And we're supposed to be interacting and interconnecting, interwoven, working together. How many of you know that hadn't happened yet? But it's evolved and designed, which when you look at the numerical value, I'm telling you, I'm teaching you like a Hebrew, because Hebrews, look at the numbers. They are just as important as any letter or any word. The numbers are very, very significant to them. They understand that that is God's secret language. That's a code that nobody else understands but them, that he's speaking to them. And he's speaking a underlying message. He's showing them the motive of what he's doing. It's 13. The vav and the zayin, when you add them up, the two letters that make up the word het, make up the 8th letter, a new beginning, when you add up their values, they equal 13. What's 13? 13 is God's number for love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. But the word, another word for love is ahava. It's the word that they use the most nowadays, ahava, and it has a numerical value of 13. And this word for het, the letters add up to 13. So it's used right here. Okay, it's right here in front of us. The 8s and the 13s. For a new beginning comes because of his love. God so loved. He loved first, didn't he? We didn't love him. I didn't even know him. He loved me even when I didn't know him. He loved me even when I was sinning. He loved me when I was mean and ugly and wretched and rotten. Sharon said, well, you still are. Okay. Anyway, but God still loves me. That's the point. God still loves me. Okay. Oh, thank you, Lord. So this word ahab for love here is an aleph, a hey, and a bet. A bait. And when you, every letter has a mystical, mystery meaning, the third layer, the deeper layer meaning in it, okay? And when you look at that, then you really know the meaning of the word. I mean, you can look in your Hebrew dictionary, whatever, you're going to get the milk. You might get, if you understand the numerical, then you're going to get some meat. But when you understand what these letters, each one of these living letters that make up the word love mean, then you get the mystery. Then you get the real deal. Then you get the motive of why God is doing what he's doing here. Aleph, Hey, and Bet put together means that Father God opened his heart again. Wow. Father God opening his heart. He didn't have to. Abraham didn't have to do this. Abraham, as a father, opened up his heart to God and said, yes, I will surrender even my son, even the one thing I love the most. I love you more. Have you opened up your heart to God that much in the way that Abraham did? It's the father-son love relationship. It's the creator and his creation. It's Abraham and Isaac. See, ahab, this letter for love, is all about intimacy. Intimacy. See, it's like a relationship. First you just get to know each other. And then you fall in love and you start dating, courting, you know, holding hands. Whatever, I won't even say that. But then it goes to the third level of total commitment called marriage. Now, we don't know what that means today, but to God, that meant eternal. It's only one that only one way the marriage covenant was ever to be broken. That was by death. Whoa. What if we instituted that as a law? You can't get divorced. You said, I do. You're committed for life. Ooh, yeah, Sharon's thing. I know where you sleep. I'm just, yeah, we're just death. That's right. That's not what I'm talking about. Natural death. Intimacy. And the Lord spoke to me, and I've said this. I'm going to say it again to you. The other day when I was studying and teaching for Paula's group a few weeks ago, the Lord said to me, I was studying on love, and I was first going to do the first teaching on love. And I was going to talk about Ahava love, 13. The Lord said, you know, I was looking at the word intimacy. Okay, Lord, we're supposed to be intimate with you. I was reading the Song of Solomon. My goodness, read the second chapter and you got to go take a cold shower. I'm not kidding you because it's all about the act of lovemaking. You just read it. It's not talking about something. That's what it's talking about. It's talking about he's wanting her lover to be like a buck, to be like a stag. That's when you look in the Hebrew, that's what those words mean. There's another word for love there. It's the word for passion. Being passionate for one another. Desiring strongly for one another. I mean, man, you read Song of Solomon chapter 2. My goodness. Whew. Go get in the shower. Make it real cold. Anyway. I'm talking to adults here. You get it. Intimacy. And so what the Lord said to me was intimacy. True intimacy. Stop it. What are you two? Man, you women, I'll tell you what. They're terrible, Marion. I can't even teach them. Look at them. Intimacy. The Lord said to me, true intimacy is to into me see. You got to see into my heart, Don. Into me see. I'm opening. The Father God is opening his heart for us to see into his heart. Into me see. That's true intimacy in the Spirit with God Almighty. And here's the principle. If you don't remember anything else I say today, except taking a cold shower, okay, intimacy, the buck and the stag, okay, this is what it means. Intimacy. This is the principle. I use it all the time. It's how you ascend. If you can see, you see into him. And when you see, you can then step in. What you see, you step into. So you see into him, you step into him. And when you step into him, what? You become intimate with him. He knows you. You know him. You know each other so well that you can finish one another's words. And so when you see into him, you step into him, you become one with him. Intimacy, the two become one. And then you speak as him. You speak out as him. That's what Jesus did. He saw what the Father was doing. He stepped in to the heart of the Father and got God's perspective. And then he spoke as the Father. Said, the words that I speak are not my words. They're the words of the one that sent me. I only see, I only do what my Father is doing. I only say what my Father is saying. I only go where my Father sends me. You with me? That's intimacy. That's real intimacy. Okay, and it says, go on, it says, thine only son, Isaac, the one that he loves so much. Isaac means laughter. It's the joy, but it's more than that. When we go into the numerical value of the name Isaac, okay, it's made up of five letters in the Hebrew alphabet, and they add up to 208, which is 2 plus 8, which is 10. Why is 10? Because this was Isaac. This was the promise. This was the beginning. Isaac was a forerunner or a foreshadow of who? Jesus. Isaac was the promised son. Jesus was the son to come. So Isaac is a picture of Jesus here that's going to be laid on an altar and sacrificed. The father was going to run a knife through his heart and he was going to pour his blood out for a blood sacrifice, a covenant to the Lord, a covenant of love, covenantal love, that he was willing to even give up the very thing that he loved the most. But he loved God more. Obedience is greater than sacrifice. And so Isaac, his name has a numerical value of 10. 10 is the beginning. 10 is the foundation of everything that's ever been created. That's why in computers, it's the binary code of creation. 1 and 0, 10. Everything, computers, they're all 10101011100. I mean, it's a computer code. It's the code of creation, though. It's not the computer code. It was God's code from the very beginning. Because 10 is the base. In math, you learn base 10. That's what we teach. You didn't learn base 8. You learned base 10. 10 is the beginning. It's the number for beginning. It's the number for the foundation. Jesus is the foundation. Is he not? Jesus is the beginning. He's the beginning. And the ending. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the Aleph and the Tav. By the way, that's what he really said because he spoke Hebrew. He said, he didn't say, I am the Alpha and Omega. He said, I am the Aleph and I am the Tav. I am God that's going to die on a cross. Wow. 10 is the beginning. It's a binary code for all of creation. And I wrote this. What is 10? 10 is a 1 and a 0. Without the 1, we are 0. Without the 1, him, you're just a big fat 0. And so am I. And apart from him, I can do nothing. But with him, I can do all things. It all started here with a father and a son in a love relationship together. Now, this is the really cool part, and I won't bore you too much more, but Moriah, they went to the land of Moriah. Moriah, in Hebrew, just looking at the surface, the milk meaning, it means to be chosen by Yahweh. Interesting. Not Elohim, but Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, God Almighty. To be chosen by God Almighty. It also, though, it means to be seen by him, or for him to see you. Wow, so there's an opening here of vision. There's an opening of the eyes. You get to that place Abraham got to the place that God told him to go, and the eyes of God were upon him, but also Abraham's eyes were upon God. They could see one another. Perfect vision, perfect spiritual vision, perfect sight. Thank you, Lord. So when we look at the letters from Moriah, I'm just going to cut to the chase here. When you look at the numerical value, when you add it up, it's 261. Now, when we add up the numbers in Hebrew, you're going to learn something here. Okay, like let's say the letter Mem. Okay, it has a numerical value of 40. Okay, but it also can be looked at just as a 4. The large gematria would be 40. The small gematria would be a 4. And so you got to look at it both ways. That's a Hebrew. They look at it that way. So if you add up the large, it's 261. Which, why is that important? Because 2 plus 1 plus 6 is 9, which is the tet, the letter tet, the ninth letter, which is the ninth letter is the letter of birthing. 9 months, you're pregnant, and then you give birth to the power of the Spirit. So this is about something being birthed. Moriah was a place of something being birthed. What was going to be birthed here? Okay, so let's dig a little deeper. The small gematria is 18. What's 18? Oh, you got to get this. It's the letter Zedek. It's the 18th letter. What's that important? Because it's the letter of righteousness. So what was God about to birth here through Abraham? It was the birthing of righteousness for all men. It was accounted to Abraham at Moriah because he was willing to give up Isaac, that because of his faith, it would be accounted to Abraham as righteousness. That's how we got in, folks, because we're the seed of Abraham. Isaac was a picture of Jesus. Jesus has been made unto us righteousness. Righteousness is a person. And because of Isaac and Abraham here, because of the Father being willing to even sacrifice his son, just like God the Father was willing to sacrifice his only begotten son in order to birth righteousness in us. That's Moriah. It's the place of the birthing of God's righteousness in mankind. And he did it through a man named Abraham. He accounted it. He counted it. He reckoned it. He took it into his counsel. He said, yes, this man is willing to give up the very son that I gave to him as a miracle and as a promise. He was willing to give up all of that promise just to have a relationship with me, just to stay in fellowship with me. And he accounted it to him. It was enough. You're a righteous man, Abraham. From this day forward, no matter what, I account it to you as put on his account as righteousness. It was also the letter Zedek, 18. It's also a place of full commitment. No turning back. It also means a place of my right side. Wow. Are you on the right side of God? Are you on the right side? Are you on the left side? The right side. Remember what came out of Adam's side? A bride. An Eve. He didn't call her Eve, though. She was just called Adam because she was of him. She was his other half. Better half is what you women would want to think. But anyway, it was his other half. In the very beginning, he was male and female. And she came out of a rib. That's garbage. That's not in the Hebrew whatsoever. There's no Hebrew word there in Genesis 1 talking about a rib. It's his side. She was the other full side of Adam. The one became two, and now the two become one. The ending equals the beginning. It's full circle, because God moves in full circles. That's why your ring, a wedding ring, is a circular wedding ring. Hebrews think circularly, not linearly. In a Hebrew mind, there's no start, and then you go down, and all that's just lost, and now you stop, and that's the end of it. No, a Hebrew circular, it always is connected forever and ever. It just continues to cycle the seasons of life. Nothing is ever lost. There is always an opportunity for everything to be redeemed, for everything to be brought to a higher level.
anyway. So Moriah was a place of the birthing of the righteousness for us. It was a picture of a man named Jesus, a son that was going to be coming forth, that was going to be made unto us righteousness. So that's why we now have his righteousness, which qualifies you to be God's friend, to be his son, and to be able to ascend into heaven now, not later. You come through that door called Jesus, who has been made our righteousness. And then it says, if you read on, it says that what? Abraham was going to offer up an offering, a burnt offering. In verse 2 it says, into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains. So we're going to look at two more words here. We're going to look at the word offering, and we're going to look at the word mountains, and then I'll stop. The word offering here is the word olah. Olah. The root word is Allah. Allah? Ever hear that word before? It means to ascend. That's why the Muslims called their God Allah, because he's the ascended one. Baloney. But anyway, who is that? Satan. Satan masquerading. He wants to ascend and he can't. He never will. He was kicked down and he never gets to go back. So this word olah for offering means ascension. A stairs that is going up. If you read in the Song of Solomon in chapter 2, it talks about the secret of the stairs. There's a secret staircase that few know of, that only the mystics, the supernatural guys, learned how to ascend the stairs of the Lord. Jacob tapped into it. He laid his head on a rock. That rock was Christ. He was opened up and he dreamed and he saw heaven open and he saw a ladder set up, a staircase. What he saw was God's DNA. DNA is spiral. It's like a spiral staircase is what it looks like. And we ascend because of his DNA that's in us. We can go up. He saw the angels going up and coming down, going up. Hallelujah. This word, olah, has a gematria, if you add the letters up, of 111. Offerings, 111. That is also the gematria. What is a one? Aleph. Not just the letter. The letter Aleph has a numerical value of one. The word Aleph for the letter has a gematria of 111. It's the beginning. It's God. It's his number, 111. Wow. And what does he want? An offering. What offering does God want now? You as a living sacrifice. That you would offer yourself as a living sacrifice. That you would offer up spiritual sacrifices. Giving praise unto him. Worshiping him. And what? Offerings, they ascend. So when you offer yourself as a living sacrifice, you've got to ascend to do that. And you go and you lay yourself on the altar in heaven before the Lord. Come boldly before the throne of grace. You ever hear that? To receive help. You come before him as a living sacrifice, as an offering. You lay your life down as an offering unto the Lord. You pour yourself out as an offering before the Lord. So 111. So when we look at those, when you look at the letters that make up this word olah, okay, it's an ayin, a vav, a lamed, and a hey, which doesn't probably mean much to you at this point, but what it is, remember I told you each one of these letters have an image and they have a meaning. There's a whole lot to them. But the ayin is the eye. The vav is like connect. It's the connector, like connection or like a hook. Okay. The lamed is the soaring. It's like the eagle. It's the letter that soars into the heights of heaven. They call it the flying tower that soars high above. That's what the Hebrews call it. So it means to soar. And hey is five, which is means open heaven. God opening his heart. Remember we started with that? Love is God opening his heart. He loved you so much, he opened his heart, and now he lets you come back in to his heart to be his son. And so when you look at these letters, you put them together, it means Father offered up his son by the Holy Spirit. It means the eye connects and you soar into heaven. It's that principle that I talked about. You see, you step in. You see into his heart, into me see, intimacy with him, relationship. You step into him, you see in, then you step in, and then you speak as him. Wow. Father, a son speaking on behalf of his father. See, that's the age of 30. That's a mature son. Because that's what God's waiting on, is for his sons to reach the age of maturity, which is 30. 30 is the age of maturity to a Hebrew. They can already be married and have kids of their own, but they're not a mature son until the age of 30. And at the age of 30, something very important would happen. The father would step out of his house, and he would, with a loud voice, he would declare to all the people in the town. He would bring his son that's 30 years old, that has his own sons and daughters, has his own marriage. But see, they all live together. They would just build on to the father's house. And the sons and the daughters would all live there. And I mean, it was the family. They weren't separated like we are. That's a work of the devil, by the way. People used to live together, families. I mean, I was raised on a hill, three generations. We all lived together. We all lived right there. We all did this. We farmed together. You know, it was the family farm. It was the family life. There was no separation. There was no just doing what you want to do, because what they did affected our house. I mean, there was accountability. That's Hebrew. They believe that's how they raise. Not so much now, but this is the original. This is what the Lord put into their heart. Nothing was more important than family. Nothing is more important than relationships. So you see him, you step into him, you speak out as him. So the father would step out and he would lift his voice and he would declare to the entire community, at the age of 30, this is my son in whom I am well pleased. You ever hear that before? That's what God did at the Jordan River with Jesus. God spoke out of heaven, this is my son. Jesus was at the age of 30. He was now mature, ready to do the works of God, ready to do the works of the Father. And the first work was to be led into the wilderness and to go through trial and temptation. And to come out in the power of the Spirit victorious. And so when the father would do that for his son in the Jewish community, everyone in the community understood what the father was saying was, I give my son full authority to speak as me, to conduct business as me. If he said it, it's me saying it. If he signed it, I have signed it. He has the same full authority and power to act as I do. I don't have to be present anymore. The Son is me, and I am the Son. We are one. We are mature. That's what God's saying. Wow. Pretty cool, huh? And where was he? On a mountain. This is really interesting. We see the English word mountains. Man, there's a lot of letters there. In Hebrew, it's just two letters. It's the word har. But it's only a hey and a resh. Two letters make up the word mountain. You know why? Because the greatest mountain is the father-son relationship. See, mountains speak of relationships. Wow. It's the hey and the resh. The hey, again, the open heart, God opening his heart, or the open heaven. The resh is the head, which was Christ, the head of the church. So not only did the father open his heart, but the mountain represents then the son, because Isaac had to be willing. Isaac was willing to die, to give up his whole life, because the father asked him to. Because he knew his God asked him to. And so the head also opened his heart. Christ opened his heart for us to receive us back in full redemption. This word, mountain, has a gematria of 205 because the resh is 200, the hey is 5, the number for grace. 205. 2 times 5 is 10, which is the beginning again. Remember that? 10, the binary code of creation, the foundation, the beginning. It's the beginning of government. 2 plus 5 is 7. 7 is the number of rest. The seventh day he rested. And so what this speaks of, what does the mountain speak of? It speaks of a king, a head, that sits upon a seat of rest and rules over the kingdom. That's what we are. 10 is also the letter Yod, which is the hand of God, the right hand of God, the open hand. It represents a hand in Scripture always represents power. So it's the power and the Zion. The 7 is the letter Zion, which is the crown. So again, we see the picture of the power of the crown, which is what? Kingship. When a man is crowned, he receives the power of a king to rule in a kingdom, to have dominion as king. So the mountain is a place of his crowning power. It's what God crowned Abraham in this place. With his power. He gave him the power to obtain wealth. What? In order to establish his covenant. Deuteronomy 8:18. This is also the place that the power of the crown is released for kingship. It's the place where the king sits on his throne, decrees and declares and demonstrates his power as king in his kingdom. So that's the picture. This whole thing with Abraham and Isaac, a father and son in a covenant love relationship with each other. There's a picture of God Almighty and the Son, Jesus Christ, and what they did for us. Hallelujah. And now we are sons of God. With the same spirit, same power, same authority, same inheritance, same kingdom. It was the Father's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. So you're supposed to be a king with a crown, sitting on a throne, ruling on a mountain in his kingdom. A son that is just like the Father, that has reached the age of maturity. So when you say it, it's because he's saying it. The same authority. I mean, if God speaks something, there's no doubt in your mind it's going to happen. But see, we got to get to that place when we are so intimate with him, intimacy, seeing into him that we know his heart. We know what he wants. He doesn't even have to say it. We see it in his heart. We just know the Father intimately. So we know what he wants to do. And so when we speak, it's him speaking and it's going to happen. When God speaks, it's going to happen. We don't doubt that. But when we speak, we doubt it's going to happen. It's immaturity. But we're going to get to that place of maturity. And when we speak, it'll be him speaking. And that's what this is all about. Intimacy. Father, son, loving one another. Loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And loving your neighbor as yourself. In these two things, all the law is fulfilled. So love is the fulfillment of all the law. Wow. Pretty cool. All we got to do is love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then love our neighbor as ourself. Love God, love the people around you. It's pretty simple. You didn't make it tough. So that's it. That's what I want to share with you. It really is about love. But there's so much in that. There's layer after layer of love. And the depth of it. All of that stuff's in there. Elohim, Isaac, promises. Laying your life down. Ruling. It all starts with love. I love him because he first loved me. And then that his love is shed abroad in my heart. So what do I do with it? Am I being a good steward with the love that he's given me? Am I loving others? Amen. I'm going to shut up now. So let's just pray. It's like the kids are done. You might want to. Okay. Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Lord. So this morning I was preacher. Today I was teacher. Lord, we thank you for your word. Oh, Lord, that it gives grace to the hearer. That it builds us up, Lord. That it strengthens us. That it puts faith in our hearts, Lord. That it gives us a picture, an image, a vision of what we are to become. Of what you see us as already done. Help us, Lord, to see us the way you see us. Help us, Lord, to look in that mirror and see you in me. Into me see. Lord, we want to see into you. We want intimacy with you. We want to know you the way that you know us, Father. And I understand, Lord, that we have to ascend. We have to go to where you are. And we have to be with you. We have to spend time with you. We have to be still with you. We have to lay down with you, Lord. And we have to listen for your words of love. We have to listen to what you're saying about us, to us. Who you say we are. Give us that new identity that we are sons of God, made in the image and the likeness, because we have your DNA, Father. We really are of you. We are you. I am your son. I have your blood. I have your bone. I have your spirit. I am you, God. I'm from you. I'm of you. In every way. Teach us, Father, how to be mature sons and how to rule. How to rule. How to be you in the earth. How to be your sons in the earth. To conduct your business, which is the business of salvation and restoration, redemption, and the restitution of all things. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Wow. Before we go, I just want you to just lift your hands. I feel like right now there's a true impartation of the Holy Spirit as he broods over us of sonship. God wants to impart sonship right now. So I just release that. I am in agreement. I speak what he's saying. Just receive your crowning of sonship. You're being crowned right now in the spirit with sonship. It's being imprinted upon your heart, upon your mind, that you are a son, fully accepted, fully loved, fully identified as God's sons to rule and reign, equal with Christ, heirs and joint heirs, co-heirs. Wow. Thank you, Lord, that I am your son. Now help me, Father, to be an obedient son. To be a good son, to be a faithful son, to be a son that will make Papa proud. And you know what that is? It's just to love him with everything within you. That's when he's so proud of you. Just love him. It's not what you do for him. It's what you give back to him. That love he first loved you with. You love him back with that. It's not even your love. It's his love. But you're willing to give it back. Thank you, Lord. Say this with me. I am a son of God. And I love him with all my heart. We need to know each other by the Spirit. We need to see each other as sons, equals. Yeah, equals, powerful. Wow. When I see you, I see Christ. Because he's the Son, and you're a son. You're just like him. You're Christ to me. Wow. We're Christ to the world. Double wow. You are the Christ to this world, the anointed of God.